Welcome to the first of many upcoming screencasts about an MCOTERM 220 CNC lathe retrofit.
Before diving deeply into the topic, please notice I'm not a professional mechanical engineer, and this is not a professional guideline. Instead, it's a presentation meant for your entertainment as well as a reference for other hobbyists maybe doing something similar like this. Okay, then let's start. Have fun. Before we start with the retrofit, few words about myself. I was born in 1981, lived all my life in Germany as a Swabian, studied information technology in 2005, so I have, from studies point of view, no clue about mechanical engineering. Nevertheless, my interest started in 2009 when I wanted to produce my own PCB, but without the hassle of using acids and doing this chemical process. Instead, I wanted to have a CNC mill to do it. At that time, I built my first CNC milling machine out of some wood, some ground round stock, and some Igus drilled-in bushings. Since then, I got and sold about 10 milling machines, some of them CNC, some more lathe, two bandsaws, and generally stumbled across and owned many MCO machines. I still have a MCO Maximat Super 11 in my basement, as well as another MCOTERM, in addition to the one I want to retrofit now. So you might ask yourself why I'm not doing a video about the retrofit. Well, the easy answer is I dislike the cutting process, and I'm also not very fond of seeing myself in a video. This is why I do this presentation. Hope you enjoy it anyways. Let's look at the raw materials first. On this picture, you can see the MCOTERM 220 as it was offered by a good friend of mine who wanted to rebuild it for himself, but never found the time. This is the MCOTERM 220, which has some more features compared to the 120 I already own. It has a pneumatic collet chuck, pneumatic tailstock, pneumatic part catcher, and more room for chips, and it's also better prepared for flood coolant. When I got it, it was complete, but in parts, and many accessories were part of the deal. For example, collets, tool holders, optics, etc. From the back, you can see the original DC motor drive. It's a very powerful one. Hopefully, I can reuse it during the retrofit. You can see the access to the chips tray, as well as the pneumatic valves and the pressure regulators and so on. On the right-hand side, you can see the access to the parts catcher tray, as well as the hollow clamping cylinder, which actuates the collet chuck. On the bottom, very well hidden behind some sheet metal, there is also the central lubrication pump. On the last picture before the transport, you can see the hollow clamping cylinder, the pneumatic chuck, the tool revolver, as well as the pneumatic tailstock. Right hand side, you can see how the shipping company picked up the machine and nearly managed to tip it over. Thankfully, it arrived. When the machine arrived, I started to take it apart. As I already have some experiences with MCOTERMs, it was very easy and fast for me to take it all apart. After 1.5 hours, I was pretty much done. Even the motor crane, which you can see on the picture, was not required. Handling of all the parts is possible for one person. One exception, of course, is the massive frame of the machine. Compared to an MCOTERM 120, which has a frame which can be dismantled, this one is welded solid. The trick to be able to move it around was to screw a furniture trolley or two on the left-hand side of the frame, and then with a good push, put it on its side. Then moving around was not an issue anymore. If you now remove the black feet, you can actually push it through a regular door, which is in Germany about 80 centimeters wide. On this picture, you can see what hell of a job lied before me. Cleaning this mess up would take some time. Unfortunately, the previous owner used to machine plastics, wood, and aluminium using cooling fluid, which clogged the perforated sheets, which are used as a filter, quite bad. Now came the biggest horror for myself. I had to transport the machine frame the biggest part of the machine down into my basement across the outside stairs. My first plan was to use a wood slide and just turn it over and push it down. However, I was not sure how I could break the fall accordingly, so I took a step back and took the time to order a new battery for my Impact Hubheber, also known as a PowerMate M1 in the US. Here you can see my Hubheber at the works. It's a very good tool to move around heavy and big equipment on your own, and it can be handled either by one or max two persons. I used it myself to move a filing machine which had around 380 kilos of gross weight, and it was pretty much possible to move it around also up the stairs, however it was borderline. Here you can see how narrow it actually was. Even though it was a tight squeeze, the walls were not touched at all, and when being at the bottom I was able to turn it around with a little bit of manhandling so I could easily enter the building. If you don't know how the PowerMate works, you can look in YouTube and search for PowerMate M1 and you can see some of the producers' videos about it. Now the really dirty job started. Cleaning up 30-year-old oil and cooling fluid mixture is really a pain. I used some machine cleaner, you can also use WD-40 if you're wealthy, and of course some Scotch-Brite or similar really fasten things up. In addition, I've also ordered 20 kilos of white racks, which will help me out during the whole process a lot. As everything else in my workshop is on casters, so I can easily move it around and clean under the machines, I also wanted to put this one on casters. However, the feet, the black ones, are also meant to take up the pan for the cooling fluid. So I was not sure putting it on casters whether it will move on me and maybe drop the pan. This is why I've added, besides the blue wheels, also a few millimeter thick steel straps to make sure it's rigid. There you see what happens to a paint job after 30 years of usage and cooling fluid. My initial plan was to only clean it up properly. However, now as the paint is chipping off in big lumps, I decided to repaint it completely. This means I will remove all of the loose paint, give it a good sand, and repaint it with some epoxy-based primer and paint, which is cooling fluid resistant. A speciality of the MCoTern 220P compared to the 120 is that the machine frame is not hollow, but it's filled with sand, even though it looks a bit. The filling holes had covers which look like the ones you know from paint cans. Unfortunately, they are totally rusted, so I had to remove them. In the picture you can also see that the paint was removed wherever it was loose and it already was sanded, so it's now ready to paint. One tip for you guys who want to paint the machine on your own, don't use sandpaper, use Scotch-Brite Red or some similar one to give it a very rough dry sand. This is sufficient so that the paint can stick and it's much faster than using sandpaper. At last I added some 2 mm thick aluminium pieces to close the holes. I glued them in place using Hylomar, which is a paste which is 100% elastic. It never hardens completely. It's typically used in the car garage as, for example, for gearboxes or similar. However, this is not a problem because when it's painted with a thick layer of primer and paint, nothing will move anymore and the gaps will be sealed. So das war's erstmal, was bis Weihnachten möglich war. Ich wünsche euch allen frohes Fest, hoffe, es hat gefallen und wenn es genug Zuspruch findet, dann gibt's auch eine Folge 2 und weitere. Macht's gut!